This morning, just remain standing for a moment. We're going to honor our veterans today and want you to get into the service and honor God. We want everything we do to honor God as we honor somebody else. Father, we thank you for this day and just trust God that everything we say, everything that we do will be a blessing unto you, and that God, all of our veterans will feel the love that we're trying to show them today. They're special people and we give them recognition. Let us all give our hearts into what we're doing, our strength and our energy, and let us praise them and praise you, God, in such a way that all people will be satisfied this day. We love you and we praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Around the pews, they're there for a reason. We want you to use those to flag, to wave as we salute today and honor today. If you see one in a place behind, beside you somewhere, grab it. And you, if you're not going to wave it, give it to somebody that will, and let's honor them today, okay?
By the dawn's early light, we're going to say, I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, and some of our youth are going to lead us in this.
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood, uniting all mankind in service.
That song speaks of heroes who, more than self, their country loved. From the days of our early American patriots through current conflicts, these are the men and women who have served our country in military service.
We want to recognize those of you who have served or are serving in our armed forces, and so we invite you to stand when the theme song for your branch of service is sung. Please allow us to honor you today.
Whenever your branch is called, please come stand up at the front.
Down we die.
Who? Getting close. Did all our veterans get a flag now? Father, we thank you today for our veterans, for the commitment that they made to you years ago, and to the commitment that they made to the United States of America. God, I thank you for the sacrifice that each of them made. And we do honor them and thank you for their service, for their love, for their pride, and for their country. And we ask for your continued blessings to be upon them and to meet every need they have. And God, to somehow with each one, heal the wounds of war that they have experienced. And we thank you for that. And we ask you in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now I want you veterans to come back here and get on, see if you can stand on this first and second step and get in close and let Rhonda take a picture of all of you today. Just come here real quickly. Stephanie, see if you can help them get lined up. Some of you get on the first step. There you go, if you can, and get real close so she can take a picture. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. See what? Oh. Let's give our veterans a big hand this morning. Yeah. You go ahead and do that song. We're okay. Thank you, buddy.
Stand with us as we sing My Eyes. Glory. I forgot the name of the song. My Eyes Have Seen the Glory. Battle Hymn of the Republic. That's it. I'm sorry. All children's church can go back to children's church now. Thank you.
Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be still, the land, my feet. 21, verses 1 and 2. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
All right. We all know. Everybody looks good today. Isn't God good to us?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for our veterans who have served and those who continue to serve our country. Let's give them another hand of praise. Yes.
Here, or maybe you just haven't filled out a visitor card. There's some in the pew. If they're not right in front of you, they'll be somewhere in the front of your pew there. But if you would take time just to fill that out for us, drop it in the offering plate, and we don't want to embarrass you but one time. So, but no, we appreciate you being here. Encourage you to just make yourself a home in the Lord. Continue to have a good time today. As we go to prayer, I'm going to share with you a few of our prayer needs on our prayer list. Continue to remember Bill Blunt and Diane, Sister Doris Callahan, Brother David had his surgery, he's home. Also, Jack Harris had his surgery this week, and he's here somewhere. He's doing good. Also, Julie Peacock at St. Vincent's, her surgery went well. We really don't have a hour-to-hour update on Julie, but she's doing good, and so keep her in your prayers. Also, the Irvin Carlson family, Brother Irvin passed away, and we're going to have the visitation at Miles and Odom Monday morning at 9 a.m., funeral at 10 a.m. So Miles and Odom, Monday morning, 9 and service at 10. Also remember my wife Maria, she's sick today, and continue to pray for all of our military here and around the world who are serving our country today, that God will certainly be with them. Also, all those in our nursing homes, it's good to have Larry and Buddy in service with us today, and continue to pray for these and the other need this morning. Now, if you have a need yourself for someone else or yourself, maybe it's something you've been praying about for a while, and maybe that God is teaching us some patience sometimes. Patience is a tough thing to learn, isn't it? But as we go older, the more we can learn, don't we? But in our Sunday school lesson this morning, it was on being content or finding contentment in the Lord. Now, there's a very thin line there between being content with things we have of this world. But if we are content with God, that means that we're in His will. We have Him in our life. Every day, the trial we're going through, Miss Mary, the things we're facing, God has already got a plan. We may not know the plan at the moment, but He's got a plan for us. And He will see us through, won't He? Amen? Amen. He will see you through. And but it says also that we could pray continuously, but rejoice in our trials. Rejoice in the Lord every day. Let Him begin the day with you as you begin your day. Let's all stand this morning and pray together. Our Father in heaven today, Lord, we know that, Lord, sometimes we get in a hurried up lifestyle, God, and that's of the world, we know, God, but we continue to praise you, God, and we continue to push forward. And Father, I know there's many here this morning that have already seen the blessing today. First of all, God, we thank you for all our veterans here today and for those around the world that have been recognized this week, God. We never take for granted our loved ones who have fallen and put their life on the line for us today so that we could be here in your house. And Father, we ask that you would bless our military. Be with each one around the world and in our country also, God, that you would protect them. Lift them up, Lord. Bless those who need guarding their mind from Satan, Lord. But Father, today we also know that there's trials in lives of our church family, God. There's needs in our life today. But we know that, God, you have promised us that you would meet any and every need we could ever ask. So today, God, we lift up the needs of others. We lift up the needs of these who have stood this morning, are standing in faith and believing today that things are going to change where change needs to be made. That we'll become content in our life with you, God. Not that we'll be complacent, but we'll be content enough to have faith and believe in you, God, that you're going to see us through whatever we face tomorrow. So bless those on our prayer list today, God. We thank you for the blessings you've already sent away. And we thank you ahead of time for what you're going to do. Thank you for Brother Danny today, Lord, that you continue to bless him in strength and spirit, Lord, today. For we sure do love you, and we give you all the praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give God another hand of praise today. Amen. You may be seated. Now this morning, as the rushers come forth, again we want to give to the Lord today because God is so very good to us. He blesses us in ways that sometimes we don't even recognize. So today we want to recognize our Lord and Savior as giving to him at least a tenth of what he's blessed us with. Father, we thank you for each one who gives today. We thank you, Father, for this place that we can come in and glorify your name because you have prepared it for us. And Father, we ask you to bless those who give from the heart because we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for giving us the ability to give to your house and to give to your work in this world. We thank you, God, for giving us this magnificent new house that we've dedicated to you. We've asked you, God, and we thank you, Lord, for blessing the folks who give. We thank you, God, for all of the continued blessings you pour out on all of our lives. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Giving baskets where we get to bless families who can't necessarily bless themselves. So I will be standing at the back door today. If you would like to sponsor a basket, now to sponsor a basket, you can go in with families. Each Sunday school could do one, or you can do one individually. It doesn't matter, but you basically go and purchase all the items for that basket, put it in the basket, and then bring it back to us next Sunday. And then we will get names and give them out to people who need them this year. So if you would like to sponsor a basket or do a basket, then at the back door, I'll be there. Just tell me today. Also, I'll be handing out sheets of paper. If you know of a family that could use a basket this year, I have the papers with me in the back. I'll hand them to you. It's got all the details on it. You fill that in and then hand it back either to myself or to the pastor. And then we will make sure those families get blessed this year. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Also, if you have a flag in your seat, if you will, please just leave them there. Then I'll collect them at the end of the service. Thank you.
Brother Danny, can I kind of give a praise report?
Yes. All right. I'm glad to see all of you here today. if you're visiting with us, I appreciate you visiting. I want you to all feel at home. We've had a wonderful tribute to our veterans. I also know this morning that we have veterans that are not with us anymore. We honor them also. Your family members, you are here, and you've had your loved ones that have passed away. We do not forget their tribute. They are included in everything we say and everything we do this morning. So the tribute is not just to those that were standing here. It is to all of our veterans and their families today. And I thank you, all of you, for what you've done for your country, what you've committed. And today we want to continue to honor you with God's word. I want you to open your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 8. We're going to look at a few verses there. Matthew chapter 8, beginning with verse 5. And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching him and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus saith unto him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered, and he said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh. And to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled, and he said to them that followed him, verily, I say unto you, I have not found so great a faith, no, not even in Israel. And I say unto you, that man shall come from the east and from the west, and they shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob as the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness, and there shall be much weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said unto the centurion, go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. And his servant was healed in the selfsame hour. Father, today is we now want to share your word. I pray, God, that you will speak through me as you choose. God, we're here to honor our veterans. But as we'll see, God, we're here to honor all Christians today. Let your word penetrate our hearts, and let that word be unto us life. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, as we look at this scripture, we want to take it and apply it to God's word. And I want to begin by reading something to you, and I want to pay close attention, not so much to the first part, but to the last part of these words. This is from the pen of John Adams. He said, the fourth day of July, 1776, will be the most memorable speech in the history of America. This country is to be celebrating by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival commemorated as the day of deliverance by solemn acts of devotion to God Almighty from one end of the continent to the other, and from this time forward forevermore. Now listen to these words that he said. I am well aware of the toil, the blood, and the treasure that it will cost us to maintain the decoration and support and defend these states. Yet through all the gloom, I can see rays of light and glory, and that the end is well worth the means. The beginning of our country, as they put it here, country founded on God. A country that recognized God, that put him first, and he's all throughout the Constitution. But then he said it's going to take great people to defend this Constitution. Great men and great women that are willing to make great sacrifices for this country, even to the blood, even to the point of shedding their own blood and the blood that it comes from there. He said, shedding not that, but their life for their country. One said, I love the United States of America. I love this country because God has established it. He has used brave men and women to fight for and even die for this great nation. I love this country because I have the freedom to worship Jesus Christ. I love this country because God uses U.S. missionaries and U.S. ministers to teach the rest of the nation about Him and His Son. I love the United States of America. That is what every veteran said when they went to join to the military. That was what they were saying. He says, however, I'm not preaching from the Declaration of Independence, nor am I preaching from the Constitution. I love God more than I love this country. Think about that. And I'm preaching from the Bible. Patriotism is good, but it has its limits. Patriotism is the willingness to kill and to be killed for trivial reasons. Patriotism is your conviction that this country is superior to all other countries because you were born in it. George Bernard Shaw said those things. And what a tribute it is. We all want to be patriots. We all declare our devotion to the United States of America. But when we look at what our veterans, the price they paid, they gave it all. They came back. And those that came back have great scars, mental as well as physical. They sustained great injuries. And today they go through hard times. It's hard to pack up in the beginning of your life, say in the early 18s, 19s, 20, and some even later. Leave everything, give your all, and come back. As you come back, you got to find a job. You got to make a lot of adjustments. It was hard to go into the military because there were great adjustments to make there. Then once you got adjusted there, then you come back. And America, at times, has not appreciated our military. I think perhaps the worst was Vietnam. There was a great misunderstanding from the top all the way to the bottom of our country. Today, we honor all soldiers. Walter came in this morning and had his vest on. I thought it was very neat the way he did it. I hope you noticed it a while ago. He spent a lot of time and a lot of money putting those badges on that vest. Things he was proud of, and he should be. And we should wear that around us with honors. You see, when we began the military, I only went so far before I was rejected because of physical conditions. But I remember that day very well. They called me home from college and had to get on a bus and drive to Jacksonville. And I'll never forget, my daddy put me in the bread truck and carried me to the bus station. And I got out and got on that bus. I didn't know anybody on there. And I had to look out the window as that bus pulled off, and I had to look at Daddy, not knowing what was ahead for me. They get you there and they run you through all this stuff, and it's a mess. I was rejected, so that's as far as I went. I don't know the rest of it. I don't know what they went through. But I do know this. They had to sign those papers, and they had to get in that long hallway where they were processed. Each person not knowing what the next thing was going to be that they were going to do. Those that were accepted then had to go to a place. They had to sleep on a bed that night, not knowing who had slept on that bed before, or whether they had lived or whether they had died. That night they had to have memories of home and uncertain of where they were going or what they were doing. They were just trusting something. Then some had to get on a plane and be flown out to places that they had never been before. Some had never been on a plane before. And left home for good as far as they knew. They had no idea that they would ever come back. No idea that that last hug that they gave to their wife, the last hug they gave to their mom and dad or brothers and sisters, not knowing whether that would be the last time they'd ever see them again. Perhaps having pictures with them that would be their constant companions and their memory of what they had left behind. Some left behind jobs, not knowing whether they came back, that job would still be there or not. They were uncertain of anything in their life, yet they were committed to what they were doing. We call them soldiers. They were great soldiers, and they were soldiers of faith. Great soldiers have great faith. Now, I want you to understand this morning, we're going to talk about our veterans, yes. But I believe that every person that is a Christian is a soldier also. The veterans are soldiers of the United States of America proudly. And we as Christians are soldiers of the cross proudly. And today we honor all of them. I was blessed by God in one sense several years ago to write this book. And we titled it Triumphant Warriors in a Turbulent World. I had no idea what I was going to do or how I was going to write it. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know how to do it. And one day as I sat in my office, I said, God, if you want me to write this book, you got to tell me what to write about. Because I had no clue. I remember I picked up a pen and in about 15 minutes I had jotted down. And when I got through, I had there outlined 20 chapters. And that's exactly what it came down to. So I began to write then on each chapter the words. And God showed me something I had never seen before. Every chapter in this book begins with something about the military. And now again, understand, I didn't serve. I've read a lot. My brother was then. I've seen a lot. But every chapter begins with something about the military. And then after that, it goes into the Christian life. It compares the two. I'd never thought about it, but they go together. And whatever the military is, we are, because we're all soldiers. And it's very interesting the way this was. It says to begin with sign up. There's a sign up period. That's just what I mentioned. Understanding your call, understanding the objectives, learning your abilities, who you are and what you have. Learning to use the weapons God's give you. Military has weapons. The Christians have weapons. But we've got to learn to use those weapons. Practicing for spiritual warfare. And then fear not. That fear of getting of the unknown. We've got to learn how to fear not. And then joy is our strength. The challenge of obedience. The challenge of it. Trusting your training. Give God the glory. Expect promotions. Enjoy rest and relaxation, R&R. Working towards retirement. Expect injuries. Facing death. Enduring with patience. Be confident. Be heroic. And then the end. That's what's in here, comparing the military and comparing the Christian life. I gave these books out. I have books left. If you don't have one, I'll gladly give you one. So you can read and understand how it parallels in our lives. Everything that we look at, everything that we think about today applies to all of us if we're going to be what God called us to be. In this story, we see here a centurion comes to Jesus. So the first thing that we notice is this man's humility. He was a great soldier. He had men under him. Centurion means century, 100. He had a men under him. He had trained those men. They were very close. They knew what to do. But now we realize something about him. This man in great position and great power also had great humility. He came to Jesus. And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching or asking something of Jesus. He asked for help. He wasn't too big or too great. One thing about our military is that we understand that our military people learn how to have humility. It used to be said when I was younger, they'd take someone who was a juvenile, someone who was breaking the law and they couldn't get straightened out, they'd say, put him in the military. And the judge back then sentenced many of them to go into the military because they said the military straightened them out. They'll get them. I don't believe that's the way it is today. I don't think it was like it was back then. It was very rigid back in those days. And they'd do certain things to you and you learn. But the thing that you did learn was humility. To be willing to ask someone else for honor, for respect, to be able to look at them and understand who you were, but understand who they are. In our Christian life today, we have to learn to have humility if we're going to be what God's called us to be. We got to understand we don't know it all. We don't have all the answers. And we need to learn to come to Jesus Christ and ask Him what it is that we need and say, God, I need your help because I can't do this. Every Christian needs to realize that we have a limited ability today, and there are many things we cannot do, but God can. And we got to learn that we never get so high on a pedestal that we can't fall on our knees before God and say, God, help me because I'm in a lot of trouble. I need your help. The military learned to do that. They learned how to be able to. You ever see the thing of a, I guess they still do it. An officer come by and they would salute. You'd always come to attention. One walks in the room, you'd stand. It's humility. Understanding there is someone else above you and over you. And you, as a soldier of the United States of America, learn how to be humble and to do the things that were necessary in your life. And it says, and then saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. He learned that he cared. See, he was nothing more than he had the faith of a soldier, great faith. I wonder this morning, how many of us in here have great faith? How many of us trust? You know, you had a uniform you had to wear. You stood out above everybody else. They knew what service you were in because of what you wore. They learned the way that you sit, the way you respected people. They saw that. But I wonder today, how many of us are great soldiers for Jesus Christ? How many of us have great faith? Do you believe that God can, and do you believe that God will, and are you willing to come to Him and ask Him for help? The second thing is that this soldier comes there because he cares about somebody. Soldiers care. You see, once they leave their family and get in that military, they begin to have new friends. They begin to meet people from other places, other states. They begin to meet people they've never seen before, and they begin in their training to work together with each other. They begin to understand that this is my friend, this is my home, this is the way it's going to be, and they learn to care for other people. I think the greatest thing is they said our motto is no one left behind. They'd go to war, and many people died in war, but they said nobody's going to be left behind. We love our comrades. You know, I don't know what it was like to be in a battle like that. But I do know that there were many times that men would sacrifice their lives because they cared for somebody else. Someone was hurt. Someone was desperate. Someone needed this. And they would go and put themselves in harm's danger just so they could reach out and minister to these people and try to help them come back to safety. We as Christians have got to care. We've got to learn that there are people around us who are hurting. See, the thing that we do is we care more for us than we do for other people. Amen. See, we've lost something the military has. They care. They look out and see those people that are in need. They see their comrades that they never knew before. They watch how they act. They slept with them. They ate with them. They lived with them. They went to war with them. That is the same picture of we as Christians. We've got to learn to care for one another. We have a great church. But you know, I bet you there are some of us don't know the name of somebody sitting over here. And somebody here don't know the name of somebody sitting over there. We just come in the same building with them. Well, see, what we have to learn, when these men would go to war, they depended on one another. So you have to learn who your comrades are. You have to learn who your friends are. You have to know what they can do. You've got to be able to go in there and read this thing and understand that, God, I need other people. I've got to care for other people. This is more about everybody else than it is about me. I've got, Jesus Christ came to this earth. He gave his life on Calvary because he cared for me and you. He wants us to have that kind of care in our life for one another. He wants us to be able to go out and visit, to be able to pray, to be able to care, to give, to love and support one another. It's the biggest call that God has for the Christian family today. We're soldiers of the cross. That means we've got to learn to do these things, and we've got to have the faith of a soldier. The soldiers gave everything. We've got to learn to do that. How much do you care for your friend? How much do you care for the person sitting beside you? How much do you care for the person sitting behind you? The person sitting in front of you? How much do you care? What are you willing to give of yourself to help that person? This soldier came to Jesus. He was a high-ranking soldier. He came to Jesus and he said, I need help because I have a servant who is sick and is going to die. A servant. Not a son or a daughter, not his wife, a servant, nobody. And he walked all that way, but came to Jesus, and he had a belief and a faith, and he said, I want you to come and help my servant. I ask you again, how much do you care for people around you? We've got to learn to give our all to every one of them if we're going to be soldiers of the cross and have the great faith, the faith of a soldier. We've also got to have belief. We've got to believe in something. When you come into the induction and you sign those papers, you have a belief in something. And it is in the United States of America. I believe in America. I love America. I want to stand up for America. I never will forget back during the Iraqi war, there was a football player that had everything. He was great. He was young. He was great, making a lot of money, had a great future ahead of him. And when that war broke out, he got so committed. He believed so much in America that he quit football and went into the military. He said, I'm going to fight for my country. And he went over there and fought and got killed. See, he had a belief in something. Football was great. Money was great. This life was great. But there was a greater calling for him, and that was for the calling of the United States of America. And he said, I'm willing to give my all because I believe in this country. Christians have got to do the same thing. You see, we need to come to Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, but we've got to have a faith in God and God's Word. We've got to believe God and God's Word. And we don't even read this enough. Many of us don't even know what this is because we don't read it. And then when we do get into Sunday school, or we come late or don't come at all, we don't listen so much to the teacher. And then when we get in here, we're distracted. We're just waiting to get through so we can get out of here. So when do you hear the word? You've got to get some kind of belief in you that I love Jesus Christ, and I'm willing to stand up and give my everything for Jesus. You got to have some kind of faith. Great soldiers have great faith. Great soldiers have great faith in the United States of America. Great soldiers of the cross have faith in Jesus Christ and God's Word. And we got to be willing to give our all. What does God want me to do? It says that faith cometh by hearing. Hearing what? The Word of God. This is our faith. Christians believe in this. And we need to stand up for this and be proud of this. This is what we believe in. And we're willing to give our life for that. It says that this man came to Jesus. And he came to Jesus and laid down everything. He did not come to him as I'm a centurion and I have great control over a lot of people and I need you to do what you're supposed to do because I'm here to tell you to do it. I have authority. And if you don't do it, I'll have my men shoot you. I'm bigger than you are, better than you are. I want you to do this for me. No, that man came to Jesus and laid down his life. His life. He didn't care who he was. I'm a centurion. That's what he said. Big deal. But I've come to you because my servant is sick. And I need you to come. I need you to heal my servant. He came and laid down his position. He laid down who he was, what he had earned. He laid down his name. He laid down his reputation. He laid everything down when he came to Jesus, and he came as a humble man believing in God. Every soldier that joined into the military, when they got there and started to do those things, they had to understand that I'm fixing to have to make some sacrifices. And I'm taking a vow that I'm willing to give my life for the United States of America. They had to sign that piece of paper. I'm willing to do it. And when they joined, they laid everything down, including their life. If it called for it, I'll give it. I promise to be faithful to the United States of America and to defend her and her rights unto my death. You see, they had to take that vow because they believe in something. And you got to lay everything down. My family, I lay it down. My pals, I lay it down. I have an objective here in front of me. And if it calls for me to go, I'm going to go. And I will go because I believe in what I'm doing. And I lay my life down. I give everything I have. We as Christians today have to have that kind of faith. See, soldiers have great faith. Great soldiers of Jesus Christ must have great faith. I'm willing to do whatever God wants me to do. Now, I understand in the military there are a lot of cowards. In a sense being, you know, we'll be honest about it. A lot of them took the wrong way out. A lot of them committed suicide. A lot of them ran. A lot of them gave up. A lot of them went AWOL. I understand all that because you had that in every group. And I'm saying that we as Christians today must stand and we must come to Jesus and we must lay our lives down and be willing to do whatever God wants us to do. But I understand also there are some in the Christian nation that's going to be AWOL. They're going to run. They're going to get away from it because they're not willing to do what God says. You see, you can't say, God, I'm willing to give you all. I surrender all to you, God. I lay my life down. What do you want me to do? When Jesus said, I want you to go visit, and we won't do it. Whenever we say, my family is more important than church and more important than God because I'm putting my family ahead of God. Whenever we come to Jesus Christ, the complete soldier, that great soldier that has great faith, is that one who's willing to say, Jesus, here I am. What do you want me to do? And then do it as he leads us. Every day of our lives, we must make that commitment. God, I'm yours. We can be Christians, and we can play a game. Soldiers that went AWOL were still called soldiers. Soldiers that committed suicide were still called soldiers. They wore the uniform. They did all those things, went through all that training. They looked like everybody else. In the end, though, they were wrong. There are many Christians that are wearing that uniform of Jesus Christ and are disobeying God, yet claiming to be soldiers. They are soldiers, but I'll tell you what, they'll never be heroes. They'll never be what God wants them to be, and they'll never be happy until they're willing to say, God, whatever it costs me, I'm willing to go that way. One day, We as soldiers of the cross here at Jesus Christ, we will never have a service where we get the privilege of coming and lining up here. We'll never have the service where people can look at us and clap and say, hey, he was a soldier of the cross, he was good. We'll never have that because soldiers of the cross don't get that here on this earth. Soldiers of the cross who had great faith will one day go to Jesus Christ and he will give us the honor and the respect that we deserve because of the life that we committed to him here on earth. I thank God for those who are willing to lay down their life. How much do you love Jesus? How many of you are willing to lay down your life physically for Jesus? How many of you are willing to stand up in the moment in the face of death and say, God, thy will be done? How many of you are willing to sacrifice your family to do God's will? How many of you are willing to sacrifice your job? Suppose God said to you, this job is wrong for you. It's wrong for you. How many of you would quit it for God? How many of you? See, you can sit in that seat and say, oh, I will. But when the fire starts, would you run or would you stay? When the fire starts, would you charge into the enemy head first, trusting in your weapons and trusting your leaders? How many of you would walk away when the fire gets hot? How many of you are willing to sacrifice your future, everything about you, for Jesus Christ? See, these are the questions that must be answered Because when you sign up for the military, that's exactly what you sign. And you're going to be held accountable for it. But when you sign your life away for Jesus Christ, that's the same thing. God, I lay down my life for you. There's nothing else before you. Nothing else. You, God, I serve first. My wills and my wants and my desires are second. My family is second. My job is second. The title of the book that was once written said, God is first, my friends are second, and I am third. Love that book. Love the title. You see, we got to get things in order because we have rebelled against God. We claim ourselves to be soldiers of the cross, yet we're living our own life, not the life that God has called for us. Great soldiers must have great faith. And I think the most sticking point is learning how to be a soldier. How do you become one? You see, we get saved. We make the sacrifice. And then we begin to live. But we don't know how to live it. We want to. See, we're taught that if we come down here to the altar and we say this certain prayer and we say certain words, or if we come to the front and shake the preacher's hand, we put our name on a roll book, that we're saved and we're on the way to heaven. And we glorify the fact that so-and-so got saved. I read a story of an evangelist the other day that he said in his crusades, he now has won over 1 million souls for Jesus Christ. And I think that's awesome. And I applaud him. But my thought is, I wonder how many of those 1 million are still serving God. You see, we begin to serve him like we think we ought to serve him. We're not being taught. We've got to learn how to live a Christian life. That's one of the chapters in this book. Okay, I'm saved. Now what? How do I live it? How do I know what to do? When we got families that aren't living for Jesus Christ the way they should, how can a son or a daughter know how to live? They hear what you say at home, they watch what you do, but then they listen where we've got to make sacrifices and they don't know how to do it. Had you come to Christ yet and laid your life down? These soldiers did. The next point is that we got to understand the cross, the cost of our service is great. It's great. The cost of joining the military. It means that you got to be willing to pay the ultimate price, which is your life. I remember many years ago reading the story of three missionaries. They just decided that, you know, God had called them to go to this foreign country to preach the gospel. And they were determined they were going to do it. They got on a plane, flew to that country, landed, began to go towards the people. And those savages threw spears and rocks and killed all three of them on the spot. And I shook my head then, and I don't now, I understand more, but I shook my head then. I said, what a waste. What a waste. They never got to share the gospel. But they went there willing to give their life, and that's exactly what it cost them. They preached greater in their death than they could ever preach in their life. The ultimate sacrifice. Would any of you do that? Oh yes, I would. If God called me, I guarantee you I'd go and do it. But yet God's called you to live for him here, and you're afraid to even do that. So how can you give the ultimate sacrifice? It's easy to sit back here and say what you would do. But when the war starts, where are you? You see, the ultimate sacrifice for us today is death, or injury, or mental problems. You can't go in there thinking about it. I know as we look back, and I remember in grammar school, the Civil War, they had these great spikes on wheels. They could be 10 or 12 foot long with spikes all the way around those wheels. And when the enemy would start up the hill, they'd just push that thing down. It would roll down the hill and roll across those people, and just spikes would just kill them instantly. We moved from there to bayonets, and we began to use bayonets as we'd charge, not knowing and understanding all that. After the bayonets, we began to have snipers, not knowing where your next step or your next breath would be. And many people were killed by snipers. Vietnam, we had tunnels that they had dug underground. And they could come up behind you and you'd never know it. In Iraq, we had IEDs, these roadside bombs. That trucks would just be riding down and they'd hit that bomb and blow them up. You see, there's been dangers of different kinds in every war. And we have to wonder, are we willing to give our life for the gospel of Jesus Christ? Every time I think of Shirley and them, our missionaries in Mexico, and every time I read these stories of what's going on over there, I think about what great faith that those two ladies must have. They're preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ in a country where the terrorist and the devil himself is destroying one life after another. They care nothing about life, only control. And Shirley and them are standing there preaching that gospel the best they can. And we need to keep them in our prayers because we've got to make sure that they're safe. Our soldiers had to make a sacrifice. We are required as Christians to be willing to make a sacrifice. See, great soldiers, it takes great faith. You want to be great for God, you got to have great faith in God. And we got to do that. You see, great faith produces great miracles. Great faith produces great miracles. We all hear war stories of things that happened where people were saved. I remember reading back in the Vietnam War that there was a man, he was a gunner in a helicopter, and he was just shooting over the enemy, and for some unknown reason, the guy on the other side of the plane, the helicopter comes to him and says, swap positions with me, I want to be on your side. And they swap positions, and the man that said, I want to swap positions, in the next moment where he was sitting there shooting that gun, he got blown up. See, had he stayed where he was, he'd have been safe. How do you do that? It's great miracles. God has a plan for all of his people. And we're going to face the enemy. There's going to be fires that we're going to have to face. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they faced that fire with their life. And they said, look, king, go ahead and do what you want to do, but I'm not going to bow down. So heat that thing up 7 times hotter and throw me in. It doesn't matter. My life isn't worth anything because God means more to me than life. And their great faith, as it was, produced a great miracle in their life. And they walked in there, and Jesus Christ walked with them. That nothing on them was burned, not even the smell of smoke was on them, because they had great faith in Jesus Christ. Daniel said, hey, king, go ahead and do what you want to do. I'm going to continue to pray to my God because I believe that's what I should do, and I'm not ashamed of God, and I will pray, even if it costs me my life. So go ahead and do what you want to do. Throw me in the lion's den. And he threw him in the lion's den, and Daniel slept great that night. Used a lion for a pillow, undoubtedly. Had a great night's sleep. And the next day, the king comes and said, open the door, let me see, is he okay? Daniel said, I'm okay, king. Come on down. You know, great faith can produce great miracles. When we face the enemy in our lives, we shouldn't give up. Let our faith get stronger. God, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know where you're going to lead me. I don't know what the end is going to be, but I know this. I love you. I committed my life to you. I signed those papers on that day when I got saved, God. And I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. Here I am, God. Use me and walk into that fire expecting great things to happen. Amen. The church today is a weak voice, and we got to get stronger in God. We got to let the world know that Jesus Christ still lives. Do you understand that when Jesus called his disciples, he said to them, look, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. At that moment, they signed a piece of paper. I will follow you. I will do what you want me to do. I will be there for you. I'll be in church with you. I'll follow you to the temple. I'll follow you to every sermon. I will be there, God. And they followed Jesus. And Jesus took them aside one day and said, men, let me tell you something. It's a great price you're going to pay to follow me. I don't want any of you to be, misunderstood. Some of you are going to go to prison. Some of you are going to be tortured. Some of you are going to have to give your life if you're going to follow me. And these men said, we're going to follow you. Whatever the cost, we'll be there. Because we're no longer fishermen. We are soldiers of the cross. Great soldiers. And we have great faith, even though they didn't understand everything about it. And they followed him. Peter, a little while later, says, Jesus, listen, I want you to know I'm here for you. Jesus said, no. He said, Peter, it's going to cost me my life. He said, oh, no. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm going to be right here with you. It wasn't but a couple of days later that there in the garden, Peter denied even knowing Jesus Christ. I don't know him. Begin to curse and begin to swear because he was afraid to give his life. He thought they would kill him, they were going to kill Jesus, and he got afraid. In the heat of the fire, he ran. When Jesus came by and looked down on Peter that day, the Bible says, you know, Peter looked up and he ran, just picked up and began to cry, and he ran out. You see, whenever we run from the fire, whenever we back up from Jesus, you can still call yourself a soldier, but you got a thing called a conscience and a heart. And it will never be the same again until you're willing to give everything to Jesus. It's worth the cost. Peter got it straight. But do you know that every disciple of Jesus Christ died a horrible, horrible, horrible death except one? Every one of them, a horrible death. You see, signing up for Jesus is not just for pomp and glory. You got to understand that what goes with it is blood, sweat, and tears. And we got to be willing to give that if we're going to be what God wants us to be. Great soldiers have great faith. See, I'm proud to be an American. I tell you, I'm proud to be a soldier. But more than that, I am proud to be a Christian. I love Jesus Christ. Oh, we salute all of our veterans today. But I salute every Christian in this room. Because you've paid a great price. Listen, when those soldiers went off to war, it talks about, you know, war was bad on the front. And yes, it was. But war was also bad on the home front. There were people back here hurting because their sons and daughters and husbands and wives were over there fighting a battle. It was a lot to have to see that person walk out of that room and get on that plane for the last time, knowing that we may never see them again. There was hurt in both places. There were wounds in both places. And I'm telling you today, give your life to Jesus. Be willing to do whatever he wants you to do. If we have things that's wrong in our life, give them up. If you're going to be a soldier, I remember the first thing they did was used to cut their hair. Cut every bit of it off. And I thought, my Lord, that's terrible. And they did that to let them know to the very beginning, you're under our control now. And we're going to show you. We're going to cut all your hair off. Then we're going to put you in a uniform, and you're going to wear exactly what we tell you to wear. You'll go to bed when we tell you to go to bed. You'll get up when we tell you to get up. You'll do this, you'll do that, you'll eat when we tell you. See, they had total control of their lives. And those soldiers either did what they said, what they were told to do, or they had consequences they had to pay. Today, as soldiers of the cross, God gave us his word, and in this word, it's the same as he did then, as America has done. God wants to cut our hair. He wants to put us in a uniform. He wants to change our looks. He wants to do everything he can to have total control of our lives. But the military demanded it, required it. Jesus wants it, but he can't require it. He can't demand it of you. Only you can give it to him. But he's calling us today to a greater life. In Jesus Christ. Can you have that kind of faith? Can you do those kind of things? Oh yeah. Because Jesus Christ is the commander in chief. He'll never lead us wrong. And he will always be there with us in the battle. Always. Leading every fight we ever go into. He's already won the victory out there. He wants us to see, hey, it's there and there's danger out there. But just follow me and stay close because I've already taken care of it. All is going to be good. Do you believe that? Do you trust God today? If you're a soldier of the cross, you got to have great faith. Great soldiers have great faith. How much faith do you have in Jesus? How much does it take? A grain of mustard seed. That's all. Just your willingness to say, yes, Lord, I will. And then when he says, do this, do it. When he says sit down, sit down. When he says stand up, stand up. When he says go, go. When he says come, come. But be like this centurion. Come to Jesus and let he present everything to him and then know. Know that God can do all. He said to him, listen, I don't even want you to come to my house. I don't deserve you to be in my house. See, we got to understand God is greater than we are. He said, just speak the word and my servant will be healed. That's great faith, isn't it? Just speak the word. He says, listen, I understand what that means because I got soldiers under me. And when I tell them to go, they go. When I tell them to stay, they stay. He said, I tell them something to do, they do it. I know, God, if you'll speak the word now, it'll happen in my life. Do you believe that? Then we got to live it. It's time that God's people begin to live like God's people. Great soldiers require great faith. If you're a great soldier this morning for Jesus Christ, stand us together. And if you're not a great soldier, would you like to be? I'll cover all of us, okay? Don't forget, I'll give you the book if you'll see me at the service. I'll give you the book. Father, today we have talked about our veterans. Great men, great women, soldiers of the United States of America. Men who gave everything for this country. Men who lived for it. Men who died for it. And today, God, we talk about Christians. Men and women who came to you because you died for them and they said, Jesus, I want you in my life. I commit my life to you. I want to love you. I want to serve you. And I know, God, that serving you, I have to give up certain things. I have to become certain things. But I'm willing to make the great sacrifice. And today, God, I tell you that I give my life for you. I'm willing to lay down my life, my future, my family, everything about me. I'm willing to lay it down at your feet. Now, God, I ask you to help us all to make that commitment today and then begin to believe in your word because your word teaches us how to have great faith. God, I pray for great soldiers to lead this nation. To lead this church. Thank you for each one who commits to you. And I tell you, I love you and trust you in Jesus' name. Amen.